mix. What I like, what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like. I mix what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like.
And not intending to put you on the spot, because this was not planned at all, but just knowing that you move in certain spaces and you know a lot more about a lot of these things than I do. But what, well, I ask it this way. Why do you think, and if I'm wrong, correct me, but why do you think that it is so hard to get people in these alternative media spaces to talk about political prisoners here in the U.S.? As opposed to any number of other issues? Am I tripping here, man? Is this blind spot not as real as I see it? Or what's going on? What do you think?
No, I think you're right. I think it's very real. I think it's because it's alien to their experience. I mean, you know, and I don't necessarily mean that in a negative way. I mean in a sociological way. I mean, I think for many of us, you know, our entry into the movement was predicated on either direct experience with or sort of reading the history of the Black liberation movement in and of itself, of its heroes, of its strugglers. I mean, when I started first getting political, one of the first issues I connected with was Mamiya. Now, of course, it was one of the bigger issues in the country, but, you know, because I had started to get interested in radical ideas by reading about the Black Panthers, reading about SNCC or whatever, his story really spoke to me in a huge way. And when Millions for Mamiya came about in 1999, that was like a revelation for me, to see all these people coming together for this, you know, completely railroaded but brilliant leader who had played such a major role throughout time and was continuing to push it, that it has such a home truth to it, because the political prisoners really do and really are the forerunners of our struggle, the people who, if we said we lived 40 years ago, we would at least hope we would be the most like, you know, maybe we can wish sometimes. I mean, I think the level of sacrifice those people made, I would never compare myself to them. I think for a lot of people who have become radicalized in the past 20 or 30 years, it's coming from a different cultural space. And I think a lot of the people in alternative media, and again, I'm not saying this in a negative way per se, you are who you are, you come from where you come from, but you know, from Occupy Wall Street, from the upsurge of the labor movement, from, you know, even I would say the context of the movement for Black Lives, in which sort of the leadership forces divorced themselves from the history of the Black liberation movement and decided to chart a different path in terms of how they viewed themselves. Now, some of them are sort of retroactively trying to act like they care, but let's just be honest. I think the early upsurge of the movement for Black Lives, it was very much like, this is not our quote unquote ancestors movement, and was basically 100% critical of past movements. Mm-hmm. And I think that created a space where a lot of people who were even radicalized around wanting Black liberation were radicalized in spaces that were not openly promoting political prisoners. So I think that people don't come from a space in many of these alternative media spaces, not that they're hostile, but that it doesn't have the same, like, why, you know, I always say no national liberation movement can survive without its political prisoners, right? Palestine, Ireland, all these other places. The Black liberation movement, I think, has been less successful in, you know, keeping that at the forefront of the movement itself, and other movements don't have the same relationship to it. So people aren't educated in a way that makes them feel like this is critically important. And I think, you know, if you push people, you can get them to say one or two things, but you have to push people, because it's not something they're constantly thinking about. We got to do something for our PPs, we got to do something for the POWs and all those other pieces. So I think a lot of it comes from, you know, maybe to summarize, because I'm all over the place. I mean, the destruction and, you know, co-option of the radical section of the Black liberation movement that left us with too many misleaders. I think the ideological confusion of the past several years that has, you know, for whatever reason, resulted in a deep disconnect between the Black radical sort of liberation tradition and sort of the current upsurge in moments. I think just the overall reality in America of it's been quite some time, you know, since there's been a true synthesis and understanding of the relationship between the national liberation struggle and the struggle for socialism. And that maybe is a bigger piece than I'm even making it right now. I'm making maybe an analysis, but my own view is that in a context in which the Black liberation movement is seen as a struggle against racism, it's gonna be difficult to understand the political prisoners as a part of the broader movement against capitalism, because it really, to understand the relationship between capitalism and racism, you have to understand the Black struggle as a struggle for national liberation and create a synthesis by which the national liberation fighters then become the tribunes, not just for the Black movement, but really for the broader anti-imperialist, anti-capitalist movement, which is who they are and what they are and the politics that they represent. But I think it's not necessarily seen as that because of what I think has been backsliding on that issue. So I'm throwing out a lot of random ideas, but those are the things that lead to it.
I mean, again, we didn't plan this. It just, just something I thought to ask as we were talking, and I appreciate the response. So, Eugene Perrier, man, thank you very much again for coming through. Breakthrough News, the punch out.
Back is also a great podcast. Aaron Monte, great sound.
I know, but that's also part of this spectrum, this constellation of folks that don't talk about political prisoners that frustrates me a little bit, even when I ask them to. So maybe I'm taking, I've even reached out to them. I'm saying I've asked them all do a segment at least. Anyway, just to please help.
No, I agree. You know? And we have to double down on pointing that out. I mean, like I said, what is the Palestinian movement without the prisoners? What is the Irish movement without the prisoners? The political prisoners, the POWs who are held behind. I mean, you see what's happening with Sundiata. A genius, you know what I'm saying? A computer scientist now suffering from some mental challenges, and we have to get these people out. It's unbelievable that it's not at a higher level and a higher flag. So I'm all for, Jared,
that's why I'm asking, because I know,
but on this one, we have to call people out because I think it's crucially important.
Like I don't get mad at other spaces when they do well in their lane. Like, I don't expect Aaron and Ben and all of them to do certain things, but I know what they do well. But for instance, Aaron will step out of their lane to interview Peniel Joseph about Stokely Carmichael, which infuriated me. And I politely reached out to him about that. Or they'll step out, or they'll do all the brilliant, when they talk about Julian Assange and make all the points that they make about Julian, every single one of them is applicable to Mumia in terms of the journalism, the critique of the state. You don't even have to talk about it in terms of racial national oppression. You could talk about it in the context of state, of liberationist journalism and state critique.
Yes.
Or just do an interview segment with someone. Again, if you can grab Peniel, who isn't even in this area of politics, to talk about Kwame Ture, then you can certainly grab Eugene Perrier to talk about Mumia. That's all I'm saying. Especially in a moment like these. That's all. So that's anyway. So
yeah, that's more than fair, and it's right. It's all for it. And people, we have to challenge people to deepen their politics. If you want to be in the anti-imperialist, anti-capitalist space, you have to be challenged to deepen your politics. Now, if you want to ride the fence, that's fine. I mean, I had the debate with Aaron about voting for Joe Biden. And I'm not just trying to randomly jump on him. But I mean, look, to me, there's a connection between those two things. I'm just being cynical. There are people who supported Biden, I know, who do support political prisoners. They tend to be Black. But, it does feel like, it also goes to me, Jared, too, is like, what is your connection to a political movement for social change also? Because I think that, the task of freeing political prisoners seems much more important when, you could be the next political prisoner. And their example is an example not of something in the past, but of what happens when you start to succeed in a big way in challenging capitalism and imperialism. And, it's not just to honor their legacy, but really it's a piece of the struggle to protect the contemporary struggle, to struggle against the political. I mean, this was the whole thing with the Irish hunger strike, was for political status, that they are not, in fact, quote unquote, criminals, but that they are prisoners of war and have to be treated under the Geneva Convention, and which provides a whole new level of protections. And I think applying that standard to our political prisoners here today is an important standard to our struggle today, if we're serious about moving it forward. But, you know, I think that there sometimes is a disconnect between the media lane people want to occupy as in a career and what that implies to their political commitments. I think, you know, everyone wants to be a commentator on left media, and that's fine. Everyone wants to do their reporting for left media and get people to share it and, you know, cover their Patreon and do all this. And again, that's fine. But the reason why we at Breakthrough News say that we're the media arm of the movement, now we're not the only one, of course, Black Power Media and other people who are out there, is
no,
because
run with that.
We're in it. You know what I'm saying? Like, and we're implicated in it, and we're not trying to separate ourselves from it. And so when we say donate to our Patreon, it's not just like so we can survive and have a career. It's because we view what we do as directly a part of these movements. So, and I'm not saying other people don't, and maybe that's unfair. Maybe some of them will text me later today or something and say they didn't like it. But I think we have to question everybody. I'm not single out anyone. Everybody in this YouTuber, Patreon, Substack world that wants our money because they're associating with anti-imperialist, radical, revolutionary ideas. Well, then like, okay, we got to question you then on some of the choices about what is going on with the content, and we have to push you. And I think if people are threatened by that, then that's the problem. I think if people can embrace it, we don't have a problem.
I mix what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like. I mix what I like, what I like, what I like, what I like.